everyone, and welcome to We Watch Bad Films, the podcast where we watch bad films so you don't have to. I'm Gary, and with me is Jay.
Hello.
Jay, have you been watching anything recently?
I don't know if I told you, but I know we keep referencing Tenet, but basically it's the only film that we saw in the cinema. And when I was watching it, I realised I haven't really seen many films with Robert Pattinson in, and I'm enjoying sort of discovering some films that he's been in the past, which sort of went under my radar and the sort of general public's radar. And I sort of been going through some of them, and I watched a film what he was in.
That's interesting, because I think I've largely ignored Robert Pattinson, other than his Harry Potter performance, the first Twilight film, and Tenet. I don't think I've seen him in anything. I'm aware he's busy toiling away, creating a decent profile for himself, which, considering, let's be honest, he started as a bit of a pretty boy actor, he's easily overlooked. I've certainly done the same to him and thought, he's just a face. But actually, I understand he's maturing into quite a decent actor. So what have you seen?
I watched The Rover, 2014, starring him and Guy Pearce.
Guy Pearce, always watchable. I like seeing Guy Pearce in a film.
He also doesn't appear very often in mega-budget films, but he's got a fairly decent career knocking around as well. And I agree, whenever he's in a film, he's always really good. Maybe not in Prometheus, but I mean, he wasn't bad in Prometheus, but we'll ignore Prometheus.
Yeah, let's just ignore Prometheus. We have a podcast with this name for this reason. Maybe we'll see it another day. Is The Rover about a dog or about an Irish drinking song?
No, it's not.
Okay.
It's quite a mysterious title, really, which you can read into. I don't want to get into spoilers because actually there's a massive spoiler knocking around, which I'm really struggling to not talk about. But I'll just tell you what the theme of the film is and what I enjoyed of it. Guy Pearce, we start on him and we're told that it's sometime in the near future after a calamity has happened. We don't know what it is, but it's post-apocalyptic, set in Australia. So it has similarities to, I suppose, Mad Max, and also a bit of The Road. So it shares that kind of world-ish, but it is its own thing. When I was watching it, I was thinking, oh, is this just going to be the same sort of thing as either Mad Max or The Road? But actually, it goes off on its own. So we start with Guy Pearce. We don't know who he is, don't know his name. He pulls up to this bedraggled roadside sort of diner. It's very mysterious what's going on in there. There's loud music being played with a couple of Asian people staring at him. He walks in and he sits down, and this loud music is playing, and it's an amazing shot, actually. As he's looking side on, he's sitting down side on to the camera, and there's a window behind him. As he's sort of just looking at away from the camera, in the window behind him, a car flips over. It's an amazing shot. He goes outside to see what's going on, and the guys in the car, they were arguing. One of them grabbed the wheel during this argument, and they crashed the car. They get out of their car. They can't move it because it's stuck, and they steal Guy Pearce's car. He comes out and he sees them doing it. He gets back into their car. He's able to move their car, and he chases after them. That is the premise.
Okay. Very mysterious, and I appreciate you keeping it so.
Yes. It's good. Yeah, you should.
Is it good overall without going any more spoilery?
I think it's very good. Now, there's not much storyline to it, and it doesn't need to be. It's about performances. Guy Pearce is good. Astounding. He sears through the screen. He is, you don't know much about him. He does talk about his past through the film, but he basically is a seething mass of anger and rage. He looks like he's just been dragged through a hedge backwards. About a third of the way through, he meets up with Robert Pattinson, who is playing the younger brother of one of the guys who stole Guy Pearce's car. And Robert Pattinson plays him as if he's got some sort of, I don't know, some sort of learning difficulty, or he's a bit distant, but he has a slight violence to him, but also he has a sort of a pure naivety to him. It's really amazing performances.
So, continuing what you said earlier, this is a good Robert Pattinson performance.
Well, yeah, his performance in this is amazing. He does these sort of facial tics and these looks in his eye. And I was thinking as I was watching the film, I'm looking into the eyes of Guy Pearce, and I'm just getting the character. I'm not getting Guy Pearce. It's an amazing thing when actors do that. You look into their eyes and you think, oh my God, they've turned into another person. They've turned into this character. And I was getting that from Robert Pattinson as well. It's so good. He's a great actor, so far, what I've seen.
So, of all the Robert Pattinson run that you've done recently, which is his best performance? One that you would recommend people go for?
I really liked him in The Lighthouse. Completely different again, completely different.
Yeah, one I've not seen. I understand it's black and white in 4:3, so deliberately trying to get rid of as many softcore fans as possible, I think. And he's
Which
fully bearded, right?
I appreciate that. I appreciate sort of like sticking to your creative guns no matter what. And actually, it's become a real critical success, The Lighthouse. And if anyone hasn't seen it, I implore them to do so. It's a very strange film and it's quite intense, but it's amazing, really. It's unlike anything you've ever seen before.
That's quite a sell. It's been on my radar, but not quite got round to it, so I'll go look for it.
It's like the Rover in as much as it's a mood piece. There's not much storyline going on. It's character and mood, and it's a bit like the Rover as well because it's intense, and the characters that Robert Pattinson and Guy Pearce are playing, a bit like Robert Pattinson and Willem Dafoe, are intense characters. It's not quite as visually unique as The Lighthouse, but the director of the Rover is an Australian director. I don't know how to pronounce his name, but it's David Michaud, and he did
Okay.
Animal Kingdom, which was I think from 2010, which I haven't seen, but has rave reviews. It also stars Guy Pearce and Joel Edgerton, who co-wrote the story for the Rover.
Joel Edgerton. That's interesting you say that. What else do we know Joel Edgerton from?
Well, he's young Uncle Owen from the Star Wars prequel saga.
The Star Wars prequel saga. His debut is, if I'm not mistaken, for Star Wars Episode 2, Attack of the Clones. I think last time we watched Episode 1, The Phantom Menace. So why don't we watch Star Wars Episode 2, Attack of the Clones?
Yes, I'm sensing some sort of theme running here.
You guys listen to a trailer. We'll go watch the film. Let's come back and discuss.
I will not let this republic be split in two. My negotiations will not fail.
If they do, there aren't enough Jedi to protect the republic. We're keepers of the peace, not soldiers.
You know I don't like it when you do that.
Sorry, Master. I forgot you don't like flying. Well, you've lost him.
If you'll excuse me.
I hate it when he does that.
Anakin, don't do anything without first consulting either myself or the Council.
You don't need guidance, Anakin. I see you becoming the greatest of all Jedi.
The boy has exceptional skills.
His abilities have made him arrogant.
Excuse me. I'm in charge of security here, m'lady.
They are using a bounty hunter named Jango Fett to create a clone army.
Wait.
We must stop them before they're ready.
Your clones are very impressive.
They'll do their job well.
Blast! That's why I hate flying!
This is a crisis. The Senate must vote the Chancellor emergency powers.
As my first act, I will create a grand
army of the Republic to counter the increasing threats of the Separatists.
There hasn't been a full-scale war since the formation of the Republic.
You must join me, Obi-Wan, and together we will destroy the Sith.
The dark side clouds everything. In grave danger you are. Begun this Clone War has.
So we've just watched Star Wars Episode 2, Attack of the Clones, from 2002. Before we talk about opinions and thoughts on it there, Jay, can you remember going to watch Attack of the Clones in the cinema and thoughts then?
It's quite a long time ago now. I remember discussing it afterwards, but I don't remember watching it. I mean, I'm assuming I watched it a few times, and potentially one of those times was with you.
I think so.
Yes, you have a better memory for these things. I can't remember what I did last week, let alone 15 years ago.
Yeah, I think we watched it in one of Basildon's finest cineplexes and watched it there. So, Attack of the Clones. I remember thinking it was quite long and relatively confusing for what it is. This whole... I usually do a recap, don't I? Can I be bothered? Do you know what? Recapping Attack of the Clones is really hard because the plot is really odd. I mentioned this with Phantom Menace, and it's odd in Attack of the Clones where you've got moving from set piece to set piece and, again, not easily describing what the characters are doing.
I remember watching Ewan McGregor talking about the plot on a TV show before it had come out. And I think he described it, it's like a murder mystery. Obi-Wan Kenobi goes off on a little sort of fact-finding mission because something happens at the beginning of the film and he goes off to discover who perpetrated it. Yeah, it's a bit weird. It's a bit weird for a Star Wars film because there's no main villain. Certainly for the majority of them, there's not a clear, we don't really know what's going on. It is a bit like a mystery. It's kind of setting up a lot of stuff, which then pays off in the next film. But there's like Padme Amidala, she's a senator. She gets like an assassination attempt on her. Obi-Wan and the now about 20-year-old Anakin Skywalker then sort of go to discover who tried to assassinate her. And then that leads to something else. They go to another planet to discover something else. They discover that clones are being made for the Republic, but nobody really knows who ordered it or why. What's Padme doing during this? She's just sort of chatting, isn't she?
She's supposed to be hidden away, isn't she? There's an attempt on her life. So she's ensconced away with Anakin protecting her. That's what's happening.
Yeah, that's it. And then they sort of...
And I'm glad after watching it maybe 100 times I say that to you and you're like, oh yeah, that's it.
It just momentarily...
When it occupies like a third of the film.
Yeah. There's a lot of chatting. So Anakin and Padme go off together and it's basically them slowly getting together. I'm going to put it that like that.
Well, you know, let's say what it is here. They are falling in love. That's what's happening here.
Yeah, apparently. It's kind of like a love film, basically. On that,
as we are told,
and John Williams really wants you to think it's a love film because he creates that amazing piece of music called Across the Stars, which is the love theme.
Love Across the Stars is an incredible theme. Of course, it almost goes without saying that John Williams is bringing everything to the table and doing all the work here.
Yes, but then Obi-Wan discovers, he follows the paper trail to this planet, Geonosis, And on this planet, he sneaks up and he spies Christopher Lee as Count Dooku and his compadres, who are the separatists, and they are creating some sort of droid army. He gets captured, Obi-Wan gets captured, Padme and Anakin go to rescue him. They also get captured, but they manage to send a signal to the Jedi, and the Jedi arrive for some reason with clone troopers and Yoda, and then there's a battle between the droids and the clone troopers, and that's basically where it ends. There's a fight, Yoda appears, fights.
Yeah.
I mean, Yoda does fight Christopher Lee. I mean,
there's lots of little bits here to discuss. Yeah. I mean, I don't know where best to start, but I tell you what, I'm going to start with Attack of the Clones is the worst Star Wars film ever made. It's
disgust.
So, so boring. There's massive chunks of it are just boring. And the scripting is the worst it ever gets to. Some of the worst dialogue, and you can feel the actors know it's absolute trash as well. And they just struggle to say it. And I'm going to skim over stuff here, but this began Lucas's pure obsession with CGI that meant that the characters' performances became lifeless.
Oh, it's the first
which doesn't help with the scripting. And this is just the beginning of the end. Added to the aforementioned, it doesn't really make a lot of sense what everybody's doing or why they're going from point A to point B. This just stinks.
Gary doesn't like this one, as you can probably tell. My opinion,
do you?
My opinion of Attack of the Clones is not quite as negative as that. I remember when I first watched it, I was like, oh, finally, the actors have been allowed to inject a bit of life into their characters. In The Phantom Menace, they shuffle on and shuffle off like they're in some amateur Shakespearean play. They just, everything is so stilted and stunted, and everyone is like dead-eyed. And there's no life behind any of the characterization. In this one, there's a few jokes. Obi-Wan cracks a few jokes. Anakin Skywalker is now around 20 years old, and he's played by Hayden Christensen, who, despite all of his critic, has a bit more life to him. He's a bit more petulant, but at least there's a bit more of a character there. That's what I remember from him.
But let's be clear, petulant is okay for the character of Anakin Skywalker. That's fine.
Felt like it was a slight step up performance-wise, but I do agree with you that the script is a clunk fest.
It's hot garbage. Some of the things poor Ewan McGregor has to say with a straight face have transcended into memehood. The most of it is absolute steaming dung. and spoilers, it's not going to let up for Revenge of the Sith. He gets just as terrible things to say in that as well.
Oh, dear. There's some good scenes in Attack of the Clones. I'm trying to be positive.
Oh, look at you jumping into the positive. All right, then. What's the good stuff in Attack of the Clones?
Well, there's some fights. There's actually a Star Wars, you know, it's called Star Wars. Despite all of the politics, there's actually some fights now. So you get clone troopers, which are the proto stormtroopers, spoiler, against the droid. It's not quite as good as having real actors fighting real actors, because both the droids and the clones are all CGI. This was the first ever fully digital film. And this is, like you said earlier, this is the one where George Lucas goes CGI heavy. It's almost like an animated film. Christopher Lee's in it. Christopher Lee's great. I mean, he doesn't have much to do or say, but when he does appear about three quarters of the way in, he's just amazing. His presence is unreal. Well,
much like Ian McDiarmid, you know, he knows what he's doing. He's been around the block a zillion times, and he knows what to do with a character, particularly an aristocratic evil person. Hey, he built his career on it. So I'm hoping George just pointed the camera at him and said, go, and off he went. You are right. He's great. But you are also right. He didn't really have a lot to do.
No.
Because he's not properly introduced as a baddie, and he's not properly set up. Really, again, structurally, he needs to be a baddie right at the beginning. Right up front, clearly plotting the story to spur it along.
Yeah, I think the problem with this film is that I think George Lucas wanted it to be a mysterious film, and he wanted some of the characters to be mysterious and sort of you can't really tell exactly where their loyalties lie. Certainly that's the vibe you get from Count Dooku when he arrives. However, because George Lucas is writing it, it's terrible. It's really done really quite badly.
And he also attempts a sort of double bluff, which is done in exactly the wrong place in the film to help you understand what's going on. When he's talking to Obi-Wan Kenobi after capturing him, and he's sort of apologising and saying he's sending for help and stuff like that. It's a mess.
Yeah. I remember watching it thinking, oh, so Count Dooku is not a bad guy. But then literally 30 seconds after that scene, they're in the sort of finale where the good guys are about to be, for some reason, not shot, but sacrificed to three different rather large beasts.
Three different monsters.
Yeah. I mean, they could have just shot them. Yeah. And then you realise, oh, well, Count Dooku is...
It's all a bit Bond villain,
yeah,
isn't
it? Count Dooku's about to kill him.
Go get your gun. We'll shoot him. We'll do it right here.
No, I want freaking sharks with freaking laser beams.
That's exactly what it is. It's like, yeah, stick them in a pit so all of these millions of flying insects can watch it happen for some reason.
Yeah, and any sort of like idea that Count Dooku may be telling the truth and he's actually a good guy and the separatists aren't bad. It's like, well, you're killing the main bad guys, well, you're trying to, so you're obviously a bad guy. I mean, the main good guys. So that's sort of thrown out the window immediately. It's nice to see Mace Windu, Samuel L. Jackson, appear and actually walk around and do some lightsaber fighting instead of just sitting with his Jedi chums looking bored, which is what he did in The Phantom Menace.
Yeah, famously gets his purple lightsaber that he specifically requested and says a none more Samuel L. Jackson line than
"This party's over."
Yeah, yet again, an amazing actor, completely wasted.
Completely kneecapped, so that he has to fit in this role. Yeah. There's so many plot threads that are picked up and thrown away and even never resolved, apart from the fact you have to go and buy an issue of a comic or something. And I've got no problem with an expanded universe, but you can't set up specific mysteries and things. You know, I'm thinking about Master Sifo Dyas. You know, they say, oh, he's ordered the clone troops. Okay, who's that then? That's never revealed within the context of these films.
Yeah, it's...
You can go and find out who this is. Look at Wikipedia and it will tell you, but... You know, you had to have read a specific issue of a specific magazine or whatever it was. And it's not fair within that context to do that.
And also...
All you need as well is one line to say it was Count Dooku in disguise or something. Or just something, you know?
"Please tell your master, Sifo Dyas, that his order will be met on time."
"I'm sorry, it's Master..."
"Jedi Master Sifo Dyas is still a leading member of the Jedi Council, is he not?"
"Master Sifo Dyas was killed almost 10 years ago."
Also, it's quite an epic part of this film, which I think is played down. It is the first chronological appearance of Boba Fett, who in the films doesn't have much to do, but outside of the films has become an iconic character. So you're introduced to Jango Fett, who never really explained why or how works with the cloners and is the donor for the clones. All the clones are cloned from him, and he asks for one specific clone to have as his son. That son he names Boba Fett. We don't understand why. We don't understand where Jango Fett is from, why he's doing these things. And then he's set up as kind of like this mysterious guy. Then he's going to be a bad guy. He's an amazing bad guy. No, you're dead. He's dead within about
5 minutes. Yeah. This is the Darth Maul scenario. He's killed off as soon as he's introduced.
But yeah, he's...
And there's lots of odd choices here. Like, Count him at Kamino. Obi-Wan suspects something is up, so goes to sort of meet Jango at Slave One. Jango just opens fire on him for no reason. Yeah. It's like, what's his plot reason for doing that? None at all.
Yeah, not only is this film sort of a mystery, What everyone's doing and why is a mystery as well. It's a mystery to the audience and the characters and everyone. Nothing really makes sense.
Nothing is more of a mystery than the love scene between Anakin and Padme. And we watched this with my wife, who said, Anakin is a damn creep. Why on earth does she see anything in
him? Well, yeah, I mean, she is an attractive, very successful, very respected politician in the center of the galaxy.
Yep.
And Anakin Skywalker is a younger, petulant, and not quite Jedi, and she could do much better, right?
Holy hell, yeah. She's probably got a pick of the universe, but... And out of nowhere, this love blossoms. And I don't mean like in a suddenly they fell in love. It was like they suddenly fall in love and she just thaws for no reason. He doesn't do anything particular. Just they have some of the worst dialogue known to man. Dialogue that makes me want to scrape the enamel from my teeth while I watch it.
From the moment I met you, all those years ago, not a day has gone by when I even thought of you. Now that I'm with you again, I'm in agony. I'm haunted by the kiss that you should never have given me.
Believe me, I wish that I could just wish away my feelings, but I can't.
Every scene that they share together in any of the films, when they're trying to be loving towards each other, it's like they're discussing wallpaper. It's so clunky and... It's awful. Okay, what about this thing? Anakin discovers that his mum has been kidnapped by sand people and he goes to rescue her. And when I remember watching it, I was thinking, oh, okay, finally Shmi Skywalker is back. Pernilla August is the actress. She's actually a good actress. She's got a good presence. And really, if you think about why Anakin Skywalker falls to the dark side, then... The relationship with his mother is a massive part of it, but she didn't have much to do in episode one, and she has even less to do in this one. And it's a bit like when Luke Skywalker in The Return of the Jedi goes to visit Yoda, and he says, Master Yoda, you can't die. And then Yoda says, watch me, and just... snuffs it in front of him, more or less. Anakin arrives, he finds his mum, and she literally dies within 45 seconds of chatting to him. It is the most... It's feeble.
He's got the death touch.
Feeble. It could have been so dramatic. The audience really could have got to know Shmi Skywalker. She is the matriarch of the Skywalker family, and yet her presence in this film is perfunctory and minimal, and I think it's a shame. It's a wasted opportunity, because they're trying to hang so much on that death of Shmi Skywalker, and it's ineffectual.
Yeah, because really it's the first time we see him properly losey. We've seen that he's impetuous and he's a bit hot-headed, and that's okay, that's a sort of his trait, but then he loses it at the sand people, which is fine, and I get it, but I feel like there's so much potential in that whole setup and payoff that is never truly followed through with. I guess he does get the line in the workshop later, you know, I will become powerful and I'll be able to prevent death.
Yeah, he does get that. Talking of the workshop and that little... that little section of scenes, I did quite like the Lars family. Cleeg Lars, he's actually played quite well. I think Joel Edgerton doesn't have hardly anything to do, but he's quite good. He looks good. He has quite a good presence as young Uncle Owen. I mean...
Hey, you know what else happens in that scene? They get to pick up Anakin's old droid, C-3PO.
For God's sake. I forgot. Well, I just want to say, before we move on to C-3PO, poor old Aunt Beru has literally nothing to say or do in this film. I think she says one word, which is hello, and that's about it.
You are exactly right.
I remember watching it thinking, why did they even bother? Why did they? Uncle Owen doesn't have to have met Aunt Beru, or if he has met her, give her some lines to say. How about that? Okay, let's talk about C-3PO. Where do we begin? I don't understand. It makes no sense, and it annoys me.
Yeah, well, if you want to hear the full wrath of Jay, go back and listen to our Phantom Menace review. But actually, what 3PO does here is even worse, because he kicks off that terrible stumbling into a droid factory
scene. I'm feeling a bit sick listening to you explain it.
I can remember in the cinema thinking, this is so bad.
Well, it would be bad anyway. But I think what makes it unacceptable is that in Attack of the Clones, if you thought that C-3PO had little to do in Episode 1 and shouldn't really have been there, and is sort of like, there's no point him being there, then in Episode 2, that goes to an Olympic standard. So C-3PO is at the Lars homestead. Now, if you've only seen one Star Wars film, it's probably Episode 4, A New Hope. And in that film, C-3PO arrives at the Lars homestead and says, "Hello, I'm C-3PO," as if he's never met any of them. Yes, he's had his mind wiped, but we don't know that yet. Why didn't Uncle Owen...
But it's equally, it's just so
it's
lazy.
So pathetic.
It's lazy, lazy, it's lazy. And yeah, sorry, I cut you off. You were about to say, and Owen should go, "Oh yeah, we had one of them."
Even if C-3PO has had his mind wiped, he's called C-3PO. It's his registration number. That's his name. Don't they remember having a droid called C-3PO who had that personality and talked about, "I can speak to binary load lifters" and all that crap? Don't they remember? Yes, he had a silver plate covering him, and now he's gold. But my God, has everyone got sort of memory problems in the Star Wars galaxy? Why is C-3PO at the Lars homestead in Episode 2, Attack of the Clones? Why is he there? I suppose you could say that he was initially with Shmi Skywalker. He went with her to the Lars homestead. But because he was set up in Episode 1, he's now a problem which has to be addressed. And so
he has to be shunted around.
So he's
around the
now
plot.
This flapping problem in the story, and he has to go with Shmi Skywalker to the Lars homestead. And now he's created a paradox in the Star Wars time space continuum. So that's part one. And then secondly, as Anakin Skywalker and Padme are getting into the ship to leave Tatooine and fly off to rescue Obi-Wan Kenobi, C-3PO gets on board. Why? He's a jumped-up butler. What on earth is he going to be able to bring to the table when they're rescuing a Jedi master? What's he going to do? Is he going to be able to translate to his captors that he wants to be set free? Why is C-3PO there? And then it just erupts into this psychedelic CGI nonsense where, oh, we realize why he's there. It's to have 10 minutes worth of C-3PO falling around making jokes and being embarrassing.
Jay, if you think Anakin making C-3PO was bad, there's some scenes that were written and never filmed for Attack of the Clones, where during this bit we were just talking about, obviously Padme's got nothing to do. So they have scenes where 3PO goes on about being naked, so Padme sort of solders on the armour for him.
Really?
So she becomes his mum. Uh-huh. So that would have been even worse.
God.
So look at what we got away with.
That is so bad. See, this is why C-3PO is a problem in the prequel trilogy. He does not need to be there. I mean, R2-D2 is one thing, but he's a much more... He doesn't have to get so involved. Oh, although talking about that, I've just realised what happens to R2-D2 in this film. Oh yeah, did you know R2-D2 can fly? Did you know that? No, you didn't know that, because it's never happened before or since.
I didn't know that. No, that would have been really handy when you go in the forest.
Oh, God. C-3PO is a travesty in this film. And R2-D2, I've just remembered, is not far behind him. How can you make R2-D2 fly? It is ridiculous. George Lucas He was at the helm of this film, and he allowed it to happen. He made it happen. He doesn't know what he's doing.
Yeah, it's all a bit, we have to get these guys in the film. How can we get these guys in the film? Oh, let's put the guys in the film.
I've heard that...
I think I need to get you off the subject, because it's killing
it
you
really
is. Talking about the droids. It's not good. So, what else is absolute shonk in this film? Okay, here's one. Where do you stand on the Yoda fight?
Well,
at the end?
Initially, when it happened, it was like, oh, wow, this is cool. This is really fun. Because in episode one, Yoda had nothing to do. He just sat around being boring. Whereas in this one, he had something to do. It's very strange to see him doing it, because we've never seen him doing it in the history of the films. But we know that he must be able to fight, and that he has a lightsaber because he's a Jedi, so he must be able to do that. When I first saw it, I thought, oh, this is exciting and interesting and fun. The more I think about it, it's a bit more complicated than that. I can definitely see why you could argue it shouldn't have happened. What do you think about it, Gary?
I am totally okay with it. Like you said, when it first happened, I was like, oh my god, Yoda can actually fight. He has a lightsaber and he jumps around like a washer kung fu style. And it's quite amazing. With time, I'm still okay with it. I think it's a lot of fun, and I think it's perfectly within the tradition of him to hobble around with a stick and then suddenly burst into life to combat Dooku and more or less be a match for him until Dooku distracts him by pulling some stuff off the walls. So I'm perfectly okay with it. One of the few things of the film I'm actually all right with. But I know a lot of people have got a problem with it.
Yeah, it's a bit iffy, but I think it's done okay. I think it's, unfortunately, it's not dated very well because of the CGI. Not sure though how they would do it now. I suppose it would still be CGI, but I don't think let me put it this way, it's not one of the worst things in this film.
So what is one of the worst things in this film?
Well,
to put it another way, what have we not discussed?
Well, it's never really clear what the whole premise of the backstory is when the Republic becomes the Empire, the Separatists, the Clone Army. Basically, it's never really clear. And you think, okay, it's a mystery in this film, but maybe in the next one and in subsequent films, they'll explain what was actually going on there. But it's never explained. So where did the clone troopers come from and why were they made? We never find this out. It's actually, if you think about it, it's quite a big plot point on a macro level. And it's never explained.
Yeah. Who has ordered 200,000 with a million on the way? Something like that. Who's ordered this amount of soldiers, basically, to be created, which is never resolved? We can kind of infer, but... That's not really acceptable.
It's not our job to infer. It's George Lucas's job to tell us. Otherwise, I could just infer.
Yeah, or better still, show us.
I could just infer, you know, 80% of the story. I think it's lazy and a bit clunky. Also,
one of the biggest mistakes I think this film made is way back when you first watch A New Hope, you are told about, my father fought in the Clone Wars. And you think, oh, the Clone Wars, that sounds exciting. So this film ends as the Clone Wars begins. And not to jump ahead too much, but the next film starts as the Clone Wars finish. So we're completely denied this entire saga of wars. Now, I know this is now dealt with in a cartoon series. I don't want to go into that right now. But you just feel like this is all the stuff that would tell you everything you need to know about Anakin. Why don't we see some Clone Wars? Some people say that you should have Attack of the Clones or its plot points as the first film in this trilogy. And then the second film is sort of bits of the Clone Wars. Revenge of the Sith stays as it is. So that you get enough
Is that because Skywalker. That's what a normal human being would have done if they were writing him? But you're Disney George Lucas, who makes the most bizarre choices in story and filming. I mean, The Phantom Menace basically is a redundant film, story-wise. Attack of the Clones should have been... You could have had parts of The Phantom Menace as either flashbacks or a little opening half an hour where little bits, little snippets of Anakin as a child. But, I mean, who wants to watch...
I think condense Phantom Menace to 30 minutes just to discover Anakin and get him off Tatooine, and I think you've done the work of Phantom Menace, and then you move on to
why would you call your saga Star Wars, and then in one of the main wars called the Clone Wars not film it? I don't understand. I don't understand you, George. You're crazy. You're crazy, George.
It's madness. It's madness. So it's got bad acting, it's got a bad script, it's got terrible CGI, and a lot of plot that doesn't make any sense. Other than that, is
okay,
it all
right? I'm going to say some positive notes. The music is fantastic. I think all of the prequels are really... John Williams is on fire. I think it's less... I know that you don't agree with me, but I think it's less wooden than... Episode one. I think there's a bit more life to the characters, which I mentioned earlier.
I disagree.
There's some interesting things which are tried in this film. So I like the idea of at the beginning where Obi-Wan Kenobi and Anakin Skywalker are chasing a would-be assassin, and they follow this assassin through the streets of the capital planet. And they go right to the bottom of the huge skyscrapers, which we've never seen before. They go into some bars and clubs. I like the idea of that. It's not done particularly well, but I like the idea of it. It's interesting. So there's an interesting chase thing.
I tell you what the interesting stuff is in there. It's just seeing Anakin and Obi-Wan together. Stuff where that happens is
well, I think also Hayden Christensen and Ewan McGregor have a pretty good chemistry together. Despite their clunky characterizations, let me put it this way. I think there's more chemistry between Ewan McGregor and Hayden Christensen than there is between Hayden and Padme Amidala.
Not difficult.
What else is good in this film?
See, you're struggling, aren't you? I'll tell you what, there is one other good thing in this film, and that's a little piece of sound design that Ben Burtt drops in. Which is Jango Fett's Sonic Charges, where all the sound is sucked from the screen.
That is undeniably, at the cinema, that was fantastic.
Yes. I distinctly remember hearing that sound again.
It zips around a lot. We go to a lot of places. I know it's all a bit nonsensical, but it's quite visually rich. We go to these different parts of the capital city, we go to new planets, and it zips around quite a bit. With the Phantom Menace, it's sort of like we spend a lot of time in Tatooine, which we've already seen, then we spend a lot of time in the capital planet Coruscant, and then we spend a lot of time in Naboo, which is basically like Lake Como. It's all a bit sort of boring. So I like that. I mean, I am absolutely struggling. I hate it as much as you do, but I definitely agree with you. There are so many clunky problems with it.
Look, I'm a huge Star Wars fan, and that means I watch the saga from time to time, and I dread watching this one every time. I have to watch it just cause.
Yeah, I understand. But for me, it's episode one. I get that dread. I'm like, oh, God, I've got to start there.
I can't tell you why I prefer one to two. Perhaps it's, I don't know. It's better to be kicked in the face than kicked in the balls.
Oh, God. I think
I cannot I just can't recommend Attack of the Clones.
I don't think I would recommend it. I would only recommend it, firstly, if you want to watch it with your children. But I would only recommend it as, like we said in a previous podcast, knowing that it's part of a saga. I think it's good to watch just to know where the characters have come from. But if you're watching it in of itself as its own sci-fi fantasy film, It is flawed to the ends of the earth. I wouldn't recommend it.
Absolutely. Well, look, what did you think of that? Do you like Attack of the Clones? Are we missing the trick? It appears there's a whole generation underneath us that absolutely get a whole gig out of Attack of the Clones that we don't. Come find us on Twitter and tell us we're wrong at We Watch Bad Films. You can also find us on Instagram at We Watch Bad Films.
Thank you very much.
Cheers and goodbye.